Thankful that we can come into the Lord's house to this day and worship Him, and we're just grateful that He is always here with us. So let's pray. Father God, we do thank You so much for Your love for each and every one of us, and Lord, that You are always here, and that You touch our hearts as only You can do. You lift us up. You carry us along, and during these days, Lord, we just need that more and more. And so, Lord, just be with each and every person here this day. Be with each person that may watch online. Lord, that You would just bless and carry and strengthen each and every one of us to be more like You, to do Your will in this church, in our community, and around the world. Lord, each and every one of us has a job to do, and we just enlist Your Holy Spirit to prod us and to help us to know what it is You want us individually to do. So we give You all the praise this morning as we continue to worship in song and in word. We just love You so much. We give it to You in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, let's sing for the beauty of the earth.
Oh,
And this morning I'm reading from Psalm 28, 1 through 9. To you I call, O Lord, my rock. Do not turn a deaf ear to me. For if you remain silent, I will be like those who have gone down to the pit. Hear my cry for mercy as I call to you for help, as I lift up my hands toward your most holy place. Do not drag me away with the wicked, with those who do evil, who speak cordially with their neighbors, but harbor malice in their hearts. Repay them for their deeds and for their evil work. Repay them for what their hands have done and bring back upon them what they deserve. Since they show no regard for the works of the Lord and what his hands have done, he will tear them down and never build them up again. Praise be to the Lord, for he has heard my cry for mercy. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and I am helped. My heart leaps for joy, and I will give thanks to him in song. The Lord is the strength of his people, a fortress of salvation for his anointed one. Save your people and bless your inheritance. Be their shepherd and carry them forever. And now let's sing, Surely Goodness and Mercy.
Good morning, everyone here, and we've got a pretty good crowd this morning, so I'm just glad that you're all here. First announcement I want to make, just so everybody's clear, the governor has put more restrictions for the next 2 weeks starting on Wednesday. That will not impact our church service, because as long as we have less than 25 people or less, we're okay. And today we have like 16 or 17, something like that. So we're doing all right, and we're going to continue to have service here, even though you have to get food takeout and all that kind of good stuff as of Wednesday. So unless you have a good cook at home, then you don't have to worry about it. I cook myself. And I won't say it's really good, it's just I cook myself. Let's see, what's going on here? Today is Communion Sunday, so we're going to have communion as we conclude this service today. And this week we're supposed to be praying for a nation, and let everybody know Marlene's sick, so I'm doing the clicking on the little videos. And so if, as it was in one of the songs, verse wasn't quite in the right order, and so I had to search around for trying to find them. But we will manage, and so just bear with us. Also, let's see, November 16th is packing the shoe boxes for the church, and they're going to start at 9:30, so if you have time to come and do that. But for all the people online and everything else, we'll still take contributions for the payment of the shoe boxes, because it costs $9 a box to have them sent in. And if we get more money than we need, that's fine. We'll just save it for next year. But if you feel the Lord put upon your heart to contribute, it takes quite a bit to get all that stuff done. And the lady's been working real hard getting it done. So I'm not sure what that is, but there's just one of those little gremlins out just scratching on my microphone or something, brother. Anyway, I'll let you look at the prayer request there. We did a church. We're going to decorate for Christmas on the first Sunday of December. And we are going to have a Christmas party. I'm going to cook a pork roast and potatoes and all that good stuff, and that's going to be on the second Sunday. Is that right? Mm-hmm. Second Sunday in December, right after church. We're going to do a minimum amount of decorating this year, and then we're going to have a party. We're going to play some bingo and give some gifts away. It's playing bingo. And we're going to do that downstairs, and we'll try to be as careful as we can possibly be doing that. But we just felt it was necessary to have at least a little bit of get-together over Christmas. So we'll plan on doing that on the second Sunday. So come and join us if you can, and we'll have a good time. Let's see. And I think with that, we better take our morning offering. So I'll get John to come forward and... Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you again so much for everything that you do for us throughout the year. And Lord, as we approach the Thanksgiving time, we just want to really concentrate on being thankful for everything you do for us. And so, Lord, as we take our morning offering this morning, would you accept it and use it to build your kingdom? And Lord, that is our prayer, that you would actually build your kingdom through the gifts that we give back to you and the work that we do for you. Lord, help us to bring more people into your kingdom. And we just give it to you in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
This morning we're going to sing Statue of Liberty, and we weren't able to sing it last week, but we want everybody to remember our country and pray for it, because it seems awfully divided, and I can't believe it, but it is. And so we thought we'd sing Statue of Liberty.
Thank you.
come next to Wonderful.
Thank you.
church should be a grateful church. Let me ask a couple questions. Do you prefer to love, or do you want to be loved? Do you prefer to love, or do you want to be loved? Do you like serving others, or do you like to be served? You know, we complain, we're not very thankful, and we hide from responsibilities. And many times our church, not necessarily our church, but many times the church is filled with proud, ungrateful weaklings. Rather than being filled with the humble, thankful, powerful people that we should be. That is often the reality and the image that is portrayed. I mean, if you ask unchurched people the definition of church, they'd probably say something like this. It's filled with hypocrites. They always stick to themselves. They always talk amongst themselves. Well, you know, to some degree, I think that's somewhat true. I mean, even when we go up and remember when we were having potlucks up at Tolbridge Park, you'd see pretty much all the churches kind of segregating themselves. Once in a while, you'd see somebody. But, you know, I like to think that we're all hypocrites in a way. Because we're all sinners trying to live a life of the non-sinner, and we can't do that on our own. We can only do that if Jesus is really helping us, and how does that give? But, you know, when we talk about how the church is looked at from the outside, the Bible gives us a different image of what the church is. And we must be grateful for God's love. I wanted to read, this is from William Temple, and the title is called So Little Place for Thanksgiving. He says, it is probable that in most of us, the spiritual life is impoverished and stunted because we give so little place to gratitude. It's more important to thank God for blessings received than to pray for them beforehand. For that forward-looking prayer, he says, though right in expression of dependence on God, is still self-centered in part. At least there is something to hope for by gaining by that prayer. But if we look at the backward-looking act of thanksgiving, it's quite free in itself. In itself, it's quite selfless. Thus it is to love. All of our love to God is in response to His love for us. It never starts on our side. We love because He first loved us. 1 John 4:19. And so our scripture today is from 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 12 through 17. And I'm going to read that, and hopefully my battery is going to be okay with the clicker. I think that's the battery getting a little bit low. I'll tell you what. I bet I can do this well enough without that, and that way you don't have to listen to go click, 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 click all the time. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that He considered me faithful, appointing me to His service. Even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display His unlimited patience as an example for those who would believe on Him and receive eternal life. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. We're going to look at five things that we can be thankful for. The first one is the thankfulness for God's love. A love that can change us. And I really think that's what we ought to be looking for in our walk with Christ. It's not just that we're loved, but that His love would change us. Change us into the likeness of Jesus and change us from being a proud person to being a humble person, a servant of the Lord Jesus. Because God's love and God has given us strength. He has given us strength. You know, in verse 12, the Greek word for strength is to be empowered, to enable, and to be made strong. You know, Godby in his commentary indicates that Paul was being filled with a dynamite in an instantaneous action. He is thankful to the Lord who fills him with that dynamite. I mean, you really think about it. You think about when Paul was Saul and he was driving, going down the road on a horse. I mean, what happened was a miraculous thing. And most of us don't see those kind of things really happen in our lives. But I think we could. Because God is able to do anything and everything. And everything that he was able to do with Saul to make him Paul and to make him one of the most read people in the Bible, he can do with each and every one of us. And God gives us strength to believe. We believe in him. We believe in Jesus Christ. Ephesians 3 tells us these words. You will be able to understand my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to men in other generations, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit of God's holy apostles and prophets. He gives us the strength to believe. He also gives us the strength to go on. And in this day and age, I think sometimes we need that strength. We need the strength to be able to go on. No matter what's happening in our world, we need to labor on. Colossians 1:29 says, I labor, struggling with all his energy, which so powerfully works in me. You see that we labor and we struggle, but it's not in our strength that we ought to be laboring. It's in the powerful strength of God that can be in us and give us the strength to be able to carry on. You know, I mean, there are days when I wake up and I just soon go back to bed. There's days when things don't go exactly the way I wanted, and I had one of those days here just a while ago. I'd just soon gone back to bed and woke up the next day. I just soon let that day just completely go by. But you know what? God's strength will allow me to continue on. And then some of us really need God's can give us emotional strength. Now that was the kind of strength I needed that day. My emotions had been really tested to the limit, and I was just needing that kind of strength that can only come from the Lord. 2 Corinthians tells us, but God, who comforts the downcast. Now see there, God comforts the downcast, comforted us by coming of Titus. I'm just letting you know that when you're down, you can look to God and he will cover you. It doesn't matter if you're 80 years old or 12 years old or 40 years old. If you really look to God, he is there to give us emotional strength to help us to carry on. But also, he considers us faithful and he appoints us for service. Not just Paul, but each and every one of us. He appoints for service. So when you're writing that word down, do me a favor. Write down there, he appoints me for service. Not Carl, but you. He appoints you for service because each and every one of us have a job to do for the Lord. And if you don't know what that job is, you're not searching hard enough. Now, the second thing that we're looking at, major point, is thankfulness for God's Son and for the cross and for salvation. As we read in the lyrics this morning, those are the things that we really ought to be focusing on. Verse 13 and 14 gives us these words. Even though I was a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and the love that are in Christ Jesus. Paul was a persecutor of the Christian faith. He was on his way to persecute, to arrest, to kill, and to wipe out Christianity. And yet, God in his power stopped him dead in his tracks and converted him to Christianity. We receive mercy from Christ when we come to him. And that grace is given abundantly. That grace is given abundantly to each and every one of us. It's not just that you get just a little bit. You get more than you need. He gives a lot of grace to cover the acts that we have done. In verse 14, Paul indicates that the Lord poured out his grace abundantly. Now, Wesley and Godby indicate a spiritual action of being given grace abundantly, completely opposite from what the belief was before. God can empower and fill us so abundantly, more than we can ever imagine. And he does that, first of all, by sins forgiven. Our sins can be forgiven just like Paul. And most of us haven't committed anywhere near the kind of acts that Paul had done. And Paul wants us to know that he considered himself the worst offender of all. You know, in all of my commentaries that I have, I researched it, and John Wesley and Adam Clark, Godby, and Matthew Henry Jameson, and even Brown, there was a unanimous consensus that Paul puts his own sins as being particularly bad, relating that if God can forgive Paul, he can forgive any of us. No matter what we do, our sins can be forgiven. There's never a time when we do a sin that God can't forgive. Recognizing in verse 16 about the acceptance and the recognition that Jesus Christ came into the world to save the sinners, Paul considered himself the first. And that God used Paul, and he uses him even today as an example to all of Christ's forgiving mercy to be shown to everyone that might believe in Jesus Christ. You know, to believe in Jesus Christ, the Greek word for to believe is really to have faith. And that is credit by implication to entrust, especially one's spiritual self being to Christ. That we have faith that Christ is going to do what he says he's going to be doing. And then third, thankfulness for the Holy Spirit. And we talk about the Holy Spirit all the time. But Adam Clark's commentary refers to the same infilling as referring to being filled with the miraculous gifts of the Holy Spirit. You know, that is what we call the power of sanctification. Sanctification, being filled with the Holy Spirit overflowing. John Wesley talked about being filled at one moment with an unbelievable strength and power that came over him. 1 Thessalonians says, it is God's will that you should be sanctified. But also, Adam Clark talks about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. I didn't put these in your notes because there wasn't enough room there, but I'm going to read you this scripture. 1 Corinthians 12, 7 through 11, through 12. And I don't have it there. Oh, yeah, I do. Let's see if I have it. Yeah, there we go. If you can read that. Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. We get those gifts for the common good, the good of the whole, not just us individually, but for the body of Christ. To one there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom, to another a message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing that by that one Spirit, to another miraculous powers, to another prophecy, to another distinguishing between spirits, to another speaking in different kinds of tongues, and to still another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are the work of the one and the same Spirit, and he distributes them to each one just as he determines. Just as a body is, though one, has many parts, but all of its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. With each and every one of us, it is one body of believers here. But we need each and every one of you, young, old, in between, male, female, we need every single part of the body for us to be whole. And so we need to do our part, whatever that part might be. Now, number four is the thankfulness for appointing us for service. And again, that's not just talking about the pastor, and that's not just talking about the teacher, that's talking about each and every one of you. I came to the Lord when I was 10 years old. I didn't remember that until many years after that. And the Lord helped me to go back in my mind and remember when I first gave my heart to the Lord. It was at that point the Lord said, I've got a plan for you. I may not have known what that plan was, but he did. And he knew how it was going to come about. In verse 16, we read, but for that very reason, I was shown mercy so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his unlimited patience as an example for those who would believe on him and receive eternal life. You see, the word for ministry means attendance. And I don't mean attendance like attending church. I mean attendance like as a servant. To be active in service, indicating more Christian service rather than the official ministry. So not each one of you is called to be an actual minister, but you are called to ministry. You are called to be involved in service. And that might be at school. You know, that might be talking to just one of your friends or when they're having a bad time. And I think we all have times when we have friends that are really down in the dumps or think life isn't going to go on. And we can give them a word of hope, a word of cheer. Not just to beat them over the head with Jesus Christ, but to let them know that there is hope for tomorrow, no matter what they might think. that by loving Jesus and having Jesus in our life, we can help other people. We have purpose in life. Now, the word anointed in the Greek denotes an upright or active position, meaning that to advise, to make or ordain, to set forth. Basically, advice means that he can control, that he can appoint, that he can select you to do whatever he wants us to do. John Wesley, in his notes in the Bible, makes a special note that Paul indicates thanksgiving that Christ put him into ministry. It is Christ that puts each and every one of us into ministry. But he also expects us to be receptive to that ministry, to be able to do the things that the Lord wants us to do. And so I want you to realize that our work, no matter who we are, our work is by divine appointment. It's not just my desire to do it for the Lord. Although I think there are some people that do that, it should always be by a divine appointment, not just our desire. And Paul is an example of a sinner who was used for service. After everything that he did, God could still use him in a mighty way to help others to come to the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And in verse 12, Paul thanks Christ for appointing him for service. I think many times in our life we want to hide from that service, or at least there are a lot of people out there that do. I know, you know, talking with pastors and friends, sometimes people join large churches because they can be more anonymous in a larger church where you can't be in a smaller church. But I want us to know that we are all. Okay, I'm sorry, I missed that one. We are all parts of the body appointed for service. Now, this one's an unknown title. It's called Thanks Be to God. I do not thank thee, Lord, that I have bread to eat while others starve, nor yet for work to do while other empty hands solicit heaven, nor for a body strong while other bodies flatten in bed in pain. No, not for these do I give thanks. But I am grateful, Lord, because my meager loaf I may divide, for that my busy hands may move to meet another's need, because my double strength I may expend to steady one who's faint. Yes, for all these things I do give thanks, for a heart to share, for a desire to bear, and for the will to live, flamed into one by deathless love. Thanks be to God for this unspeakable his gift. You know, if we all thought that way more uniformly, maybe we could accomplish more for the Lord. Well, the fifth last thankfulness is the thankfulness for God's sovereignty. For his sovereignty and for his love for each and every one of us. Verse 17 says these words. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, to be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. In verse 17 is exalting Christ as King of eternity. Wesley describes this as a phrase frequently used with the Hebrew meaning, how unspeakably sweet is the thought of eternity to believers. We look forward to that at some point. I don't think we all look forward to it right now, but we do hope that someday we'll spend eternity with other believers in the King's presence. You see, the King is eternal. Literally, it means that he is the king of all ages. He's beyond anything that we can imagine. He's beyond time as we imagine. He is the only eternal thing that has ever been. He's immortal, meaning that death does not have any effect on him. And there's only one God. Angels do not compare. No one, nothing compares with God. I think in our human abilities, we have a tendency to want to try to bring him down to a level that we can really understand and we can comprehend. But just like the child that has faith in daddy, and I'm sure that probably one of you guys have had times when you were up on a box or something and you jumped and dad caught you, or you had the kind of faith of dad doing that. And you see, that's just instill that kind of thing. I mean, we have faith and we trust our daddy. We can trust God just the same. Even though we don't see him, we can trust him just as much. Nothing compares to him. There's no other God in his kingdom. He is eternal, immortal, invisible. And Paul says, honor and glory be to him forever and ever. And so as we conclude this morning, I just want us to think about a couple things. First of all, the church is a gathering of undeserving sinners saved by grace of mighty God. You know, really, that's what we are. We're fallible. We make mistakes. We mess up. And yet God, because we didn't deserve it, granted mercy on us and allowed us to become part of his family. We cannot help but to accept others, to help them, and to give them thanks, and to give thanks and praise to God, who makes everything possible. You see, God receives the glory. God receives all of our praise. And as we approach Thanksgiving, in other words, we leave the Veterans Day weekend and go to Thanksgiving, we need to be thankful and grateful for all that God does for us. And this day, I don't want you to sit there discouraged because of everything we see in the news and the media. Because we need to stand in the Spirit encouraged that one day we'll spend eternity with our Lord. And as I preached last week, as part of that sermon was preached almost 10 years ago. And I preach that to let us all realize that no matter what's happening in our world, we're going to get through it. And there may be a struggle during that process, but if we go in the Spirit of God, if we go with the strength of the Holy Spirit, we'll be able to make it through. And so, our prayer ought to be that we might be, number one, a thankful people. We need to be thankful for everything that God does for us. Just the fact that we can be here in church, we ought to be thankful for. Even if we have to wear a mask or whatever, we just be thankful that we can be in his presence and that his Holy Spirit will be there. And we ought to pray that we can be a humble people. Because we need to be humble in order to serve. We need to be humble in order to really show God that we really, truly honor him and give him respect. And we need to be a changing people. Each and every day of our lives, we ought to be changing, growing closer and closer to what God wants us to be. Because, see, people who are not afraid to show weakness, we can be weak no matter what. And so may the Lord right now pour out his grace so that we'll flood your soul. That his love is like a funnel of love. You know, I don't know, most of the men have put oil in the car. And, you know, we have a little funnel. Wouldn't it be nice if we just take that funnel and let God pour his love into us? Not over the top, but it would fill us completely on the inside and out. And that, as we do that, we're going to have communion. And so our worship team's going to come up. We're going to sing a song. And we're going to have communion. And then we'll conclude with our service. As we go, I'm going to give you a chance to actually open your little thing, get the first little layer up there for the little biscuit. And while you're doing that, I'm going to share just a little word for the Lord as we've been talking about being thankful. And this is from Colossians chapter 3, starting at verse 12. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another in all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, Do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and Father through him. As the disciples were gathered together and before Jesus' death, he gave them an opportunity to really understand and know what was about to happen to him, even though they didn't. Not like you and I know after the fact. It's a lot easier to look back and see what happened versus trying to see forward. But just like with his disciples, we're to be grateful for what he has done for us, because the forgiveness of sins alone should be enough to be grateful. But not only does he forgive our sins, but he allows us to be part of the body. And you know, we may not have as many young people as I'd like. We may not have as many men as we like. But we're still the body of Christ here in Parkdale. And we come together as the body of Christ to be a joint, be a family. And even when we get together in our families over Thanksgiving, there's going to be some young and there's going to be some old, and we still get together as family. And that we owe to Christ. And not only that, but the fact that we can spend all of eternity with him one day in heaven. Getting to be renewed with those that have gone before. What a great thing that he has done for us. And so as he told his disciples that this is the bread that was broken, will be broken for your sins, we do it in remembrance of what happened to our Lord. That our sins can be forgiven because his broken body and because of his shed blood. And so let's always do that remembrance of what he has done for us. So let's partake of the bread, remembering that Jesus had his body broken for you and for me. Let's partake. And then as you open up the cup with the grape juice, Jesus said, as he held up the wine, he said, this is my blood shed for the forgiveness of sins. And as we look back on our own lives and look at the lives that we have led before and after Jesus has come into our lives, we can be thankful for all that he has done for us, that he would pay the price on the cross of Calvary, that our sins would be forgiven. And so as we partake of the juice, let's do that also in remembrance and in love for what Jesus has done for each and every one of us. Let's partake of the juice. And let's pray. Heavenly Father, again, thank you so much for your word today. Thank you for your love. Father, I thank you for this family that you've allowed us to have here in Parkdale. It's not a perfect family, but it's your family. It's my family. It's our family. Young or old, thin or heavy, doesn't make it there. Male, female. Lord, we're just part of your family. And we can support one another and love one another and lift up one another and help each other grow in our relationship with you and with relationship with one another. So we just thank you so much for all that you do. And we thank you for the forgiveness of our sins that we might be entitled to have one day. Be called good and faithful servant as we enter into your kingdom. Help us, Lord, to be humble, to be compassionate, to be giving, and to help others in that walk as well. Whatever you want for us, Lord, allow your Holy Spirit to tell us and guide us, each and every one, And we just thank you today to give you all the praise in the powerful name of Jesus Christ, we ask it. And the church said, amen. Have a great godly day, and we'll see you next week.